Salve Maria, welcome to our extra program on the Assumption of Our Lady into Heaven in Body and Soul, the 15th of August. Dr. Pini would like to say a word about clemency, about Our Lady saying clemency, because she is in the Salve Regina, say, oh clement, oh loving, oh sweet Virgin Mary. That's a very important attribute of Our Lady, says. Because we have to realize that the queenship that Our Lady exerted on the human race is not that of a judge, but that of an advocate, you see. Because she has not as a mission to judge and to punish sinners, but to defend them. It's a very big difference. No? For this, she has for us all kinds of favorable predispositions and always attends to us with ineffable goodness and kindness. Therefore, the modern soul, who is very attribulated and worried and concerned with all kinds of problems like that, and treated with terrible harshness by the present-day tyranny of the devil, see, it finds it a bit difficult in understanding the true sense of clemency of Our Lady. All the more so because there is a false piety that exists which presents this mercy as a very sweetened and soft way, as if she had a kind of complicity with error. Now, the tenderness and the goodness of Our Lady never consisted in a vile condescendence with he who practices evil, but yes, in the maternal and invariable disposition of conceding to him the necessary graces to abandon error and sin. There's a big difference, you see. And it's this sense that we must understand the clemency of Our Lady. And as such, she is unique, supreme, and inexpressible. Now, the Order of Our Lady of Mount Carmel, as it were, with the Assumption of her into heaven, receives a kind of apogee, because we can imagine that when she was in Palestine, in the Holy Land, nothing would present her to going to Mount Carmel and being there present with all her sons, all the hermits that were there, which we had occasion to speak about in the month of July, you see. So there was established, with her entering heaven, a relation between the devotion of Our Lady of Mount Carmel, or Carmel, and glory, the persecuted, faithful, prophetic devotion fights until the moment in which it is confirmed by God and begins to shine at the highest point of heaven in the person of the Virgin Mother. See? Who could imagine such a magnificence, such great, such a glory? See? Only perhaps those who were able to see something of this, you see. Because it was necessary to have seen and admired the terrestrial relationship between both her son, our Lord, and her, Our Lady, to understand the richness of sentiments that was contained in this re-encounter in heaven, you see. And in there we can form a pale idea of the gaze with which Jesus, from the height of his throne of splendor, considered the excelsis presence of his own mother entering into paradise. More than that, even if our spirit becomes tremulous when we think of he is God, superior to all others, inundated with perfect jubilation, we would dare to say the divine Redeemer would allow himself to be touched with a most supreme pleasure and a supreme respect at the moment in which he crowned the immaculate forehead of Our Lady with a crown of inequal graces, a crown of unequaled graces. Who can imagine such glory? This exceeds everything which is given to us to imagine, which is beyond our capacity to imagine, he says. And if God promised to himself as being for us the recompense that was too great reserved to those who love him, we are remained more confused when we've tried to imagine how great and how exceedingly superior would be this prize, this gift, this grace for the creature who he filled with his own flesh, who did not suffer the corruption of the death, because it was not just that a person who had given her own flesh and blood to God should suffer the corruption of death, like all of us will have to suffer. All of us, the bodies turn into dust, but not her. She was her body and soul. Her body also was taken into heaven, you see. because it is just that this has taken place. The amount of solicitude and maternal tenderness and the love of which he has for us is incommensurable, unsurpassable, you see. The joys, Our Lady had great joys at this moment, and we can also have devotion to these joys, you see. None of the joys that she had in this earth were greater or reached the height of those she had when she was assumed into heaven. After she, as so it were, slept before, as it were, had the dormition, which is in guise of what would normally would call death, but it wasn't a real death. We can imagine what we want, because the church hasn't defined itself as regarding that point. Said Our Lady resuscitated at the height of her physical state, but also at the height of her spiritual state, because the maturity of the body and the maturity of the soul are related among themselves. On the day of the Assumption, Our Lady was in the fullness of sanctity. Her soul, most holy soul, not even 1 minute during her existence on this earth, had reached its climax. The Virgin Mary was filled with supreme perfection. She had incomparable beauty of soul because she was full of virtue. Her love of God had reached its high point, its apogee. This sanctity shone in all of her person and gave her an incomparable beauty. When she entered into heaven, we can imagine the cortege entering into heaven. First, the incountable amount of angels, who gave to her a homage that no earthly queen on this earth had ever by far received. Never, no. And she understood the nature of each soul, their primordial light, their own characteristic, the grace received by each one, the love of God, and the love that God had for each one of them. Mary Most Holy had the perfect knowledge of the hyperdulia, those are the graces of devotion, is dulia, hyperdulia, and latria, which is only to God, you see, that the myriad angels gave to her. And she, having a full joy for each one of these praises, knew that they deserved it because the reflection, the most faithful reflection, had been the mother of our Lord Jesus Christ. Anyone else who was not freed from the effects of original sin would have had the temptation to become proud. I said, "Oh, but they're admiring me in such a way. No one ever received the honor and the praise that I'm receiving here." It would go, if it was any one of us, I shudder to think what we would believe. But with Our Lady, absolutely nothing of that took place, because she was not subject to these temptations, to vanity, to self-contemplation, to egotism, etc. So, being a mere human creature, Our Lady was receiving an enthusiastic love of all the angels, and the court, which during thousands of years had waited for its queen, became transformed into something most beautiful because she was arriving. The beauty in the world, angelic world, had not reached all its beauty at the point that it was created for, because it was necessary that a human creature govern this body of angels. Our Lady crowned with the most high perfection the beauty of heaven. And then, of course, she had found herself with the holy souls that had come up into heaven following the death of our Lord Jesus Christ. And certainly she found herself with St. Joseph. The re-encounter with St. Joseph must have been something extraordinary, because he would have seen her and said, "Oh, but she has become much holier than when I left earth." Of course, he had died before. So God the Father took him into heaven before our Lord began his public mission. No? The respect and the grace and the smile and the mutual understanding that Our Lady and St. Joseph must have had is something absolutely extraordinary, something which, just to think about it, it does good to our souls, you see. The beauty and the shining of this grace of Our Lady, which had grown continuously in grace and holiness, was reflected, for example, in the encounter with St. Joseph. St. Joachim and St. Anne, her parents, you see, were also invited by our Lord, her son, to be present, and it was good that they be so, because they had been perfect with her. They had been very good parents of her, you see, to the point of being in a special place of honor, watching her entry into heaven. Well, Adam and Eve, the first parents, because they had been forgiven by our Lord, you see, they were in heaven, you see. could contemplate there, who had caused original sin, could contemplate there the reward given by God to solve this problem of this sin, making our Lord Jesus Christ be born and glorifying his mother in such a way, the Immaculate Mother of the Redeemer, she who would overcome the problem that they had caused by committing original sin, you see. And we can imagine all the other faithful souls, which she knew perfectly well who they were, in heaven waiting for her and granting her a very deserved welcome. No? So to end up, we say the Assumption reaches its high point, the crowning of Our Lady as Queen of angels and of saints, of heaven and of earth by the Most Holy Trinity. There was then a true feast in heaven, a true celebration in heaven. This is not hyperbole, this is not an exaggeration, but it's an authentic feast in the terms and ways that we cannot imagine. It was the highest point of joy that can be that can exist, that can ever be reached. It was crowned by Our Lady being Mother of our Lord Jesus Christ, daughter of the Eternal Father and spouse of the Most Holy Spirit. So there, my dear friends, we have a reflection on the feast day of today, the Assumption of Our Lady into Heaven, which, as we said, is the most joyous feast that had the greatest joy since the feast that had taken place after the ascension of our own begotten Son into heaven. So to conclude, we will give you our blessing. May Almighty God bless you all in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Salve Maria.